I'm Tim DeChristopher. I'm a climate activist from Utah. I work with a group there called Peaceful Uprising that I helped start a couple years ago. The thing that launched that and that kind of launched my career as an activist was that I disrupted a BLM oil and gas auction at the end of 2008. That the Bush administration was giving kind of a parting gift to the oil and gas industry. And I ended up registering as a bidder and outbidding most of the oil companies there, for which I was later indicted on a couple of felony charges and have been going through a big legal process ever since. I was convicted of two of those felonies, and I'll be going to sentencing later this summer on July 26th. And I've basically just continued to be a climate activist throughout that time, and have been traveling around talking to people about where the climate movement is at, and where I think it needs to go and has the potential to go. So that's why I'm here at Netroots.
Now, can I get you to talk a little bit about some of the finer details of your case? I mean, is there any situation where you could have been let off for what you did at the auction?
Yeah, there was certainly a lot of different paths that this could have taken. Before I was ever indicted, before any charges were pressed, the Obama administration overturned the auction and admitted that it was illegal in the first place. Not because of my actions, but because the BLM wasn't following their own rules. And it was after that that the Obama Justice Department indicted me and pressed charges. And they certainly had the option of not doing that. They've continued to pursue the indictment since then. Now at this point with the sentencing, the Obama Justice Department is pushing for 4.5 years, which is pretty much the maximum that there's any claim for in the sentencing guidelines. The maximum that they could reasonably ask for is 4.5 years. They certainly have other options, and it's not necessarily a popular move for them to go after a completely nonviolent activist who was standing in the way of something that was admittedly illegal, and try to put me in jail for 4.5 years. But I think that they're dependent on the same corporate interests that the Bush administration was. They're still trying to please the oil industry, and so they're making an example out of me to get to that goal.
Now, do you feel like maybe you were made an example? Because there are other instances in the case of the Obama administration where, at least with the Justice Department, they've gone after activists who are taking, I guess you could say, matters into their own hands and doing the sort of actions that you did in this case.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Obama administration is no different than any of the ones before it in its pursuit of activists. Of trying to instill in citizens the idea that we don't have the right to stand up to our government when it's acting illegally. Any time a citizen is doing that, it's always an inherent threat to the government, because any act of civil disobedience is a small statement that we don't respect the government's sole moral authority in terms of what's right or wrong. The law is not the only thing that determines what's right or wrong, and we're going to operate out of a higher sense of justice and morality. That's the principles behind civil disobedience. And so that is an inherent criticism, in a small way, of the government's moral authority. And so I think they always need to get that back by either vilifying the activist that's standing up to them, or talking that person into a plea bargain, which is what they generally do, and getting that person to come before the court, and hang their head down, and say, "I'm sorry for what I've done," and I throw myself at the mercy of the court. They need that to regain their moral authority, or otherwise, it continues to undermine their authority as more and more people engage in that activity, and then their choices are either change their behavior or lose their moral authority. They were in that situation with a lot of social movements in the past that have been successful. Like the Freedom Riders made it clear that they were going to have to keep putting people in jail or end bus segregation. Those are the only two options. And it was an embarrassment to the government to keep putting principled, nonviolent young people in jail. It started to undermine their credibility. And so they had to take that action of ending bus segregation.
Now, as you're sentenced and then you do go to prison, how do you intend to continue your dedication to the causes and the activism that you've engaged in within the walls of a prison?
Well, I mean, I certainly intend to keep writing and getting my message out as much as possible. But, you know, I also realize that other people are going to have to fill that role while I'm in prison. You know, Peaceful Uprising has been building and maturing over these last 2.5 years, and I think has developed some really strong leaders that can step in when I have to go to prison. And I think we're going to see that more and more around the country. You know, if a movement's dependent upon one person, it's going to fail. You know, and whether it's me going to prison or you know, something else that happens later down the road, you know, eventually if the movement is counting on me solely as an individual, they're going to be let down. Whether it's because I'm not there anymore or because I, you know, just go crazy and wander out into the desert. Eventually, I'm going to let them down, and you know. So, I think there has to be that willingness to learn what we can from individuals, validate their actions, but also be willing to move on and take their place and fill their shoes. And
my final question to you is just: can you describe why we're at the point now with the environment where people need to take the kind of bold actions that you took at the auction? I mean, it seems to me that there is a reason maybe why we can't just stand outside with pickets anymore. We can't just petition the government. Do you want to describe why we're at the point where we have to take bold actions like we did?
Well, I think the movement has been trying to work within the system for a long time, and it hasn't worked. And there's several reasons for that. I mean, one is that those who write the rules are those who profit from the status quo. And so if we want to change that status quo, we might have to work outside of those rules because, you know, the legal pathways available to us have been structured precisely to make sure that we don't make any substantial change. And the change that we're talking about moving away from a fossil fuel economy that always leads to a concentration of wealth, about moving away from an economy based on an ever-increasing consumption of material goods, these things are inherent threats to our current power structure. They're threats to our economic system and the vast disparities of wealth that it leads to, because renewable energy inherently leads to a more distributed economic system and a more distributed political system. And you know, so we should acknowledge that what we are talking about is overthrowing our current power structure, and that will take some sacrifice on our point. It will take us escalating the tension in the situation, so that the country has to come down on one side or another. And really, that's how it's been with most social movements that have been advocating for significant change. They've had to make major sacrifices. They've had to escalate the tension in the situation to the point that it couldn't be avoided. We're no different from those, and we should be willing to make the same sacrifices that so many activists in the past have done.